thanks to Network 18 who has given this brilliant partnership to host this event in a first international destination for Inspiring Conversations. Inspiring Conversations is a concept where we love to learn from the experiences of successful entrepreneurs across the country and across the world. We are today with one such entrepreneur where I don't need him to be introduced to people from Dubai or people who have traveled all the way from Mumbai. There are more than 32 people who have flown in specially for today from Mumbai. I would like to thank them. Today we are doing the 26th session and the first one in Dubai. You'll see this happening very often in Dubai. We begin with a very renowned personality, Dr. Ram Buxani. It's a pleasure and a privilege to know him, and we will walk through his journey. It's a very interactive session. We never discuss personal life, public life, religious life, or political life. Well, in Dubai, there are no politics. You don't have the fun that we have back home. But we will definitely be discussing his journey of life. We all know that a picture speaks a thousand words. Today, I'm going to show you a picture which will speak about a journey which took 58 years. For that, I would like to request Mr. Nagu Chidambaram and Geeta Chidambaram to come up, please. 3.5 years back, Inspiring Conversations was started by interviewing Nagu Chidambaram and Geeta Chidambaram, one of the most dynamic entrepreneurs that I know. They are a very dynamic couple from whom I keep learning a lot of aspects. And I would like them to give this frame to Dr. Ram Buxani in the beginning. But there is a story behind this frame. Like I said, every picture speaks a thousand words. I would like to give this to Dr. Ram Buxani in the beginning and explain the thousand words. Dr. Ram Buxani, if you can just hold it, I would like to explain it for the audience. In 1959, Dr. Ram Buxani, after a 5-day journey on a boat, I can't do that even today. I can be on a cruise liner, not on a boat. Taking a journey of 5 days from Mumbai to Dubai, he came and started his journey. I would like you all to hold this picture for a minute for me to explain the entire 58 years journey. You can see in the picture Dr. Ram Buxani, and there is a dhow boat next to him. That time Dubai was a very shallow creek. Yes, and Burj Al Arab is also there. During that creek, you come from a big ship, get transferred to a small boat. The boat can be visible in the picture. It's coming out of his heart at the moment. It's close to his heart. You can see the birds on the top. That is how he grew in his life. After he came here as just an 18-year-old, he was an overweight child at that point of time, not knowing to swim. He doesn't know to swim even today. And he traveled by ship for 5 days. And this is where he came by the dhow boat. He grew in this country and he saw the growth of Dubai happening around him. The picture speaks a thousand stories of the boat that he came by, of him and the city which has grown around him, and the birds behind on the top left hand side still say that the journey is not yet over and is still flying very high. So doesn't the picture speak a thousand words? Have you had a look at this?
Yes, I wanted to have that way. Audience was looking at it.
Yes. We'll keep it for you. We'll hand it over. So today I was in his office and I saw a lot of pictures in his office with Indira Gandhi, with Narendra Modi. Of course, when you scale such heights, there is nobody who doesn't want to meet you. So that's what happened with Dr. Ram Buxani. And the first statement I made was, it's a lovely life to live when you challenge yourself to do something different than what has already been done. And that's the time I told him that today I'm going to gift you with something which will adorn the walls of your hall. It will be dramatically different from what is already there. And this will be the first picture which will talk of your 58 years of journey from the day you landed on the shores of Dubai till today and forever. So that painting, I'm sure Dr. Buxani will be putting up tomorrow and will have an inspection in the evening.
Tomorrow is Friday. And day after tomorrow, I understand you are leaving.
Yes. So friends, let us share. It's always wonderful to learn from people who have made it big. We would like to explore the journey of Dr. Ram Buxani, and we need to take anecdotes from them and implement in our life so that we also become more successful like Dr. Ram Buxani. In 1959, you crossed seven seas and came here. And in 2017, we did the same to catch up your story. 5 days on the ship as a youngster. I think that must be your first outing on a ship of that long.
That's correct.
That long a time. What was the anxiety running on your mind for those 5 days? Because 5 days is a long time.
But before that, let me tell you something very interesting about the preceding session which you had. We are talking about inspiring
conversations.
But I could see that when you said that gold will go on rising in prices, and the only thing is what we need to buy is real estate.
Because I'm not a goldsmith, I'm a real estate guy. So
I'm sure that must have inspired everybody.
That is the objective. And you missed out a very interesting talk by the ma'am here. She heads a very prominent organization, and where she inspired the people so much that I know who's my first investor after the session.
I mean, don't underestimate her. She is a lawyer. I could make out as to who would have made the speech.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Yes, yes, yes,
yes. You asked me as to what really...
what was working on your mind?
What was working in my mind? Nothing very seriously, because at the age of 18 years, I got the job overseas. I was in the ship, quite relaxed, nothing so serious. But I knew that I am going to Dubai to make my earning, which will help me in taking care of my family. Nothing very serious. But on the way, definitely, one incident happened. Because the ship stopped in Karachi, in Muscat, in Gwadar, and finally coming to Dubai. And Karachi, that is the place where I was born. Not in Karachi, but Hyderabad, which is...
Sindh.
Sindh. And so many people were just getting down to go into the city. That I could not do because I had nobody to look to in Karachi, and also I had no visa and no money to get out. Yeah. But that feeling I carried for many days, that I went to the place where I was born, but I could not see it. But subsequently, last year, I got an opportunity to go, and that was fully compensated.
Fantastic. When you came to Dubai, you started with a salary of 125 rupees.
Yes.
I'm sure 125 rupees in 1959 was a big amount.
Was a good amount.
It was an awesome amount. And you landed here when there were no roads, there were no motors, there was no power, there was no potable water to drink. And it was a very stiff situation. Did it cross your mind that I should go back?
No. It never came to my mind to go back, because I was living the way all the people living here, they were living. There was no electricity, and as you said, there was no water. They used to bring water on donkeys from faraway places, and the water contained all the ingredients which were required to make you strong.
Cockroaches, ants.
Cockroaches.
So that built up your immunity system.
Yes, sir. And after having taken Dubai water, when we returned to India, the Indian water never affected us.
Fantastic. You saw the Dubai then. Then in 1959, 1960s, the Dubai had only in totality 1 kilometer of land. Half kilometer on the Bar Dubai side, yes. Half kilometer on the Dera side.
Yes. It was Dubai, whole town was half a kilometer.
Only Mina Bazaar part.
No, Mina Bazaar was not there.
Okay.
No. This was the other side of museum. And Dera also, it was up to Nasir Square. Half a kilometer. And since there was no telephone, we had to walk to everyone we wanted to meet. And by that way, we were meeting whole town. That means practically one could get in touch with whole Dubai every day without failure. And it was fun. It was such brotherly feeling.
So Dubai didn't even have an airport then, and letters coming in from India used to be delivered in Bahrain, and then from Bahrain they used to come into Dubai, and from Sharjah, Sharjah.
Letters.
And then from Sharjah it used to come to you.
We had no airport in Dubai. We had a small Royal Air Force air base in Sharjah. The mail used to come by Gulf Aviation flights, not Gulf Air, Gulf Aviation, from Bahrain to Dubai, from Bahrain to Sharjah. Then from Sharjah, those mail bags would come by Land Rover to Dera, because there was no bridge also. So from Dera, it would cross by boat to Dubai side, because there was only one post office that was on Dubai side. And so no sooner the bag arrived, they will start sorting, and very anxious faces. I mean, outside the post office, you would find all the big names, foreigners, Indians, Pakistanis, or local, they would gather there, pick up one by one. I mean, every 3 minutes, 4 minutes, they will keep on opening the post box.
Like how we keep checking the WhatsApp these days.
Yes, exactly.
So you're
exactly. And not only that, they will take out the letter, immediately start opening. There will be many letters about hawala business, but many letters would have come from the families. Somebody would be waiting for a letter from his wife or brother or mother. It was quite exciting.
So it was a great networking opportunity for you.
Yes, you met all
big people there. I'm sure exchanged ideas and got more intelligent on business.
Twice a week. But earlier to that, when there was no post office, they used to gather in the center of the town, and the person who would bring the mail bag from Sharjah, he will open it and announce the names. Bindu. And if Bindu is there, she will collect the letter.
Yeah, she's our next investor, actually.
If Bindu is not there, then Hemant will take away the letter.
Absolutely. Friends, when he came in 1959 as an employee at 125 rupees a month, he immediately graduated in the next 4 months, becoming a profit shareholder, which means he became a partner in profits. And subsequently today, for the ITL Cosmos Group, which is one of the most renowned in this part of the world, he is the chairman of the same organization, and he is the largest shareholder in that company. I think that was a phenomenal growth. And what is also interesting is there were only 5 post boxes before the 6th one was allotted to a person who was not from the origins of the land, and that was ITL Cosmos. So post box number 6 belongs to the ITL Cosmos Group. Second history in this city for us to know, since Dr. Ram Buxani is originally an Indian. His is the first company, ITL Cosmos is the first company which was given the decree or the license to do business by His Excellency Sheikh Rashid himself personally in 1953.
His Highness.
1958, the license was given. So the first license ever given to any outsider other than people who are locals was ITL Cosmos.
Locals, they did not require anything. As a matter of fact, there was no culture of any licensing here. To do a business in Dubai was so simple. I mean, you would arrive in Dubai, hire a shop and start the business.
So what was that you did to impress your employer that he made you a partner in profits?
No. I think he tried to impress me.
Oh.
And before that, let me tell you, I mean, 125 rupees was a big salary at that time. And along with that, I mean, this is a Sindhi firm. And besides salary, they used to give so many other perks also. But perks were not free car.
No ESOPs, no stock options, nothing.
So, house was there. Food was provided 2 times, cinema ticket in a month, shaving allowance was given. That means actual expenses towards shaving cream and that was given. Two times haircut in a month. So all these expenses were looked after. There was no way to spend money in Dubai then.
So even as an employee, your salary was your net profit.
Absolutely. And you know, you asked me how I became the partner. After 3 years, our chairman had come here. He said, I give you two propositions. Either I increase your salary from 125 to 400, or I increase to 300 plus 3% profit share. According to profit figures at that time, I could feel that if I accept 400, no profit share, still I will be making better bargain than the one. But I said, no, let me take a chance, let me take a risk, because if I am not capable of earning enough for the company, there is no point in, getting riskless salary. And that could put me in trouble any time.
How much time did it take for you to take that decision?
Not even a minute.
So that is a Sindhi mind.
So I said 300 rupees and 3% profit share. I like that instead of 400 straight. And I think he got the message.
So I'm sure a lot of us acknowledge and accept that Punjabi, Sindhi, Marwadi, Gujaratis are the best entrepreneurs India has produced. And we love emulating them. They are known across the world. You had a boss who was a Sindhi. You were also a Sindhi. So was there a mind war on who gets what from the efforts both are putting in?
No, he was getting better than me because he was Sindhi.
Was he also thinking the same thing?
Yeah. Yeah. And this gives you a challenge that if you are getting 3% profit share, you have to make 100 to qualify for 3. That means 97 goes to somebody, but that should not bother anybody because a company who provides you that opportunity, they deserve that. So I was not worried about 97, I was worried about 3.
Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. Dr. Buxani, you began the job with a company which was into textiles. Subsequently, a lot of scope of activities changed in Dubai. You all also went into diversification. What was your strategic planning or what was your strategic thinking whenever you took a decision of diversification into a new sector?
I think in those days, one did not really do any sort of planning so far items in which you have to deal with. Anything which sells, sold, we could get into it. I remember we used to deal in tomato paste from Italy because tomato was not available, so we used to bring tomato paste. We used to import agar-agar, which is kyle China grass. We used to import from China. And orange juice. Hundreds of thousands of cartons we used to get from Japan. And mackerels from China again. So there was no restriction about the items which you were dealing in. We started with textiles, that is very, that is true. And textile was coming mainly from India and China and America. Japan was not in picture at that time. So we were totally open to the items. Anything which, yes, we used to deal in footwear from Italy. So anything which sold, we can. There was no specialization required.
So Dubai was never a license Raj, even then?
No.
So anybody could get the tomatoes and the shoes and the electronics and the textiles and all of that.
And you
how were you different from the market? You were sitting in the hotbed of the market. So what you could get is what all could get. How could you manage this phenomenal growth and how were you different by trading in the same products which others are doing as a competition to you?
Typical Sindhi style, less profit.
How did you tackle how did you tackle the other competitive Sindhis?
I think there was room for all.
So you made the room as a, you made the room into a hall and the other room became bathrooms, I think. Because you grew the way nobody else grew. So I think, I'm sure you must be having some strategy.
Basically on one side is growth and then earning and then expenditure. Maybe we were little we were a little conservative on expenditure side.
What was your review mechanism? We talk about reviews, review meetings, board meetings, all of that now in the last 25, 30 years.
Yes.
What did you do 58 years back? When you took up a new business model, was there a review mechanism of this particular line of business giving me X returns and that business Y returns, this is better to do?
No, not that.
You kept
that,
doing everything.
Because there were no licenses also. I mean, there were no trade license. Of course, we got the government decree at that time, but since even Dubai municipality was not in existence, so you did not require any license. So you can basically deal in anything what you wanted to, and sometimes it could turn into profitable business.
Sitting in Dubai, you got the exposure of the whole world. The whole world became a market for you.
That's right.
No restriction.
No restriction.
I'm sure what you did here, in any other country, it would have been very difficult to do because it was free economy here.
Mm.
In this scenario, were you always an importer or did you also start exporting something to the other countries?
So anything in Dubai which was imported was meant for export. Whether we do it or somebody else is doing, but and we had designated markets totally. Iran was one of the biggest market and Pakistan was a good market before India became the market here. And many of the people who are sitting in this audience, they must be knowing. India, we say market. For us, it was a market. For India, it was a smuggling.
Right.
And it was substantial business until India started producing the those items themselves.
As an entrepreneur, what will you rate yourself? As a better decision maker, as a better people manager, as a better finance manager, or as a better business manager?
I think one has to be all.
What were your best decisions of life? Were the decisions in terms of finance or people?
My best decision is that I came here.
That was your sole decision. After that, which was your best decision? Is your decision on finance better than your decision on people, or is your decision better on the people who make the money for you?
I don't think you can say that people can make money for you. Because basically when it's a trading operation, you have to be involved. So it's a joint effort. If it was a manufacturing unit, which Dubai has started getting into manufacture, but when I came here, it was totally trading, and trading requires a different type of...
What kind of monitoring systems did you have those days for leakages, like people swindling stuff, swindling money? What kind of mechanism did you have to monitor the people?
I think the atmosphere itself was so different. We did not have much of those activities, what we see today or what you are talking about. People were honest. We did not, there was no police station also. People were very, very honest, and that sort of, these doubts which you are feeling about, I don't think such situation was there.
Your company created a Dr. Ram Buxani. How many Ram Buxanis did you create in your company?
I feel everybody in my company is Ram Buxani.
I'm talking about bank balances.
My bank balance is theirs.
I hope they are listening to this video. You have had a very interesting journey. Some story that you would like to share where you were different from the other businessmen in the same city.
I think this is a little odd question. Perhaps you be specific, I'll reply you.
In your life journey, so sometimes a man gets a lottery by buying a lottery ticket. Sometimes a man gets a lottery by taking a right decision. What was that decision of yours which was a jackpot for you?
I think
every grown man has got that one big jump which made him bigger in life. So what would you identify that big jump as and where?
This we already said. One I talked that when...
The percentage game.
Percent, yeah, when the share in profit was offered to me and I picked up, and since then it has been always, growing exercise for me. And the fact that nature sent me to Dubai, which was, in total open playground, that itself is a very important thing. Because people don't get that much opportunity. And I'm sure those who are old-timers, and some of their parents were here, they had equal experience because one could play with the situation.
Do you believe in collaborative working?
Yes.
Do you partner with people and companies?
Yes.
You do that? Yes. You believe in that?
Yes. Yeah, but particularly in the lines which you are not involved. For example, we were the first company, the first hotel of Dubai was our collaborator working in Dubai. And
what was that? Ambassador?
Ambassador Hotel.
Lula.
Astoria Hotel. So Lula was managing, but
you all owned it
majorly, and
I think those were the first hotels.
Major means substantially major.
I think those were the first hotels of Dubai.
Yes, first hotel of Dubai. Before that, they had a small hotel, airlines, which was shut down. The Dubai's first hotel was airlines hotel, which was shut down, and Ambassador followed, which was our joint venture. Managed by Lula's, even Astoria. And both the buildings belong to the ruler of this place, and they are rented properties. I don't know how many of you know about that, but these are rented properties belonging to ruler of Dubai. And because these are very historical places, and they have not attempted to break it and make...
Coincidentally, on 9th of August 1994, I travelled first time abroad, that was Dubai, and I stayed in Astoria Hotel.
Yes.
And those were the only few good hotels in that point of time.
Yes, Astoria Hotel has a lot of history, and so is Ambassador. When Ambassador was the only hotel, all ministers, I won't say any prime minister came there, but many ministers from different countries, they stayed there. And to get a room in Ambassador was very difficult, and people used to use our influence or request Mr. Lula to give them a room.
What do you believe in? Growth by adding more people or growth by investment of money? What growth do you believe in?
Both. You can't invest money without growing the without adding the people.
Because the formula for wealth creation is different for different people.
That's correct. That's correct. When a person gets tired and he has no energy to work, then growth of money is being thought of. But when a person is active, growth of human resources is more important, because then you are adding your service to the humanity, and also you are contributing to society.
What is your vision today? Before I open the audience for questions, what is your vision today? In the current scenario, Dubai having grown to be one of the best cities in the world, what is your vision today?
We have to be, even in Dubai, what growth you are seeing and everybody is seeing, I think we have to be all very cautious. We have to see and check as to how far, how deep one can swim. One can get drowned in this situation. One has to be really careful.
That's your advice to the audience.
Yes.
Lovely. Audience, can we start questions from your end as well? Yes, Nagu.
I have been here for last 58 years. And
and you want to stay long.
Yes.
My voice is good. That was fantastic. Thank you very much. Quick question. 58 years back, what drove you? Do you still have the drive today? If so, what is driving you today?
I think the place itself is can drive everyone, because the honesty, the operation, the enthusiasm which even locals have, that gives you a lot of drive.
So your personal drive, Doctor, what is it that you wanted that time? And you're still running, you're still pushing.
Do you have the same hunger is what he wants to ask?
What's your hunger?
I would not say I have got that hunger, because at that time I came here to look after my family. As I said, in 1959, when I came here, the situation was different. But today, my hunger is quite different, to serve the society, to serve the humanity, and you get from one side and pass on to another side. This is, I'm saying simply a bridge connecting different sides, because ultimately you are a postman. We are all postmen in this life. We get the letter which has to be delivered, and if you don't deliver it, you just leave it, and then somebody will take away anyway.
Fantastic. Yes, Makaran. Yes, Ani.
Doctor, good evening. That has been fantastic session so far. Now, you've been involved in decision making since you've been an employee, then a 3% partner, then probably your share kept on increasing, and then you're currently the major stakeholder. How does that decision making evolved during the period of time?
Honestly speaking, this is not a decision making. All this has been coming. So I don't have to take any decision. And previously, my employers, this share went on increasing. Then that opportunity came to invest. So I invested. Opportunity came to invest more shares. That also I did it, because ultimately we have to generate the money for serving the society as it.
Makaran.
Good evening, Doctor.
Good evening.
What is your view about investing in India, and if yes, in which industry? Thank you.
You are one of the member of the delegation which has arrived today.
But he is not into real estate.
See, investing in India as a motherland, yeah, definitely, it's an excellent idea. But Dubai, people living in Dubai, I don't think they are matured enough to invest and still be safe in our own motherland. They have to have different thought process, because if two persons sit on the table in India negotiating a business, the base of, intention of both of them would be as to, who should win.
It's a chess game.
So that happens there. Because in India people live in that atmosphere. There are lot of bureaucracy, lot of red tapeism all over. The things are much, much different here. I'm sure if a person who is resident of this place, like I've been here for 58 years, the person who is resident of place, he is not exposed to that sort of situation. So, in case of India, yes, it is our mother country. We come and spend money, and this I am telling because having lost lot of money, not in any venture I have invested, because we are not efficient enough for our own motherland.
Fantastic! That is the skill set of the locals there. Deepak bhai.
Yes, but there have been some people who, now if we see Reliance, they came winding up their
business in Eden.
Their business, and they came there. They have But if we do it with remote control, this remote control will be my hand and control will be gone.
Deepak bhai. Good evening, Dr. Ambaksani.
Yes.
Hello, yes sir.
Yeah.
Good evening. You said your present passion is serving society and humanity. So can you tell us how do you do that? So that can inspire us also to do that.
No, I don't think once the intention is there, one gets lot of opportunities. For serving, you don't have to really plan or anything. There will be opportunity and you just pick it up.
He is associated with Al Noor, a training organization for the differently abled people. Very passionately is involved with that. He is involved with the development of his Sindhi community in a very big way, in a very large way. He holds positions of power in a lot of Indian schools. He is also on the board of the Chinmaya Mission School in Coimbatore. So I think there is a lot of social involvement, and I guess today his time commitment to social initiatives is more than business commitments, right?
I think so.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yeah, Rohit.
So once, intentions are there, opportunities come.
So Dr. Rambaksani, it was a super fine session. Now that, again, what you have told Mr. Deepak, that you want to pass it on. So how about starting a business management school in this style so that we can learn something from you?
Business management school?
In Sindhi style.
Sindhi style. The problem is, Sindhis are still struggling to have their existence in their own country. So let that be finalized.
Thank you.
Next question, please. Yes, Vijay.
Two questions. One is, one personality that you have been looking up to all your life, a legacy whom you wanted to as a role model, and a failure at the other end whom you saw as in your life. And second question is, to your successor, to the legacy that you leave, what is that one mantra that you would want them to follow, or what is that one inspirational quote or thought that you want to leave for them which they follow and they can reach you?
Who is your role model? Who has been your role model is what he asked.
I mean, many a time I always take people like G.R.D. Tata. Parsi as a community, we need to learn from them quite a lot. I don't know how many Parsis are here in the hall. So, he created Air India. We all know it. And it was simply taken over and ruined almost. But they have not reacted bitterly against that. I mean, this is something what we should be proud of, and they created another airline. So they say, we don't bother what you do, and you can take away whatever you can take, and still we can carry. So, and if you, I don't know how many of you know that Tata once went to Apollo Hotel and he was not allowed entry.
Yes.
And,
yes.
And Apollo Hotel is also very near to Apollo Bandar in Bombay, very near to Regal Cinema, who are from Bombay, they must know. And he was not allowed entry. And he said, this was in British days, and he said, one day I'm going to make a hotel myself. And he made it. He made Taj, and we know, I mean, whatever Parsis do, I mean, I'm not myself Parsi, I'm not brokering for them, but I mean, this is what is the fact. I mean, we need to follow them.
I think one more credit which goes to J.R.D. Tata is when he established his Jamshedpur factory, he first created place for the workers to stay, and then he built the factory. So he first ensured that the people are comfortable, and then he established the factory where he could make money. So these are some rare qualities, and that's what is your role model,
yes.
J.R.D. Tata.
Yes.
The next question, yeah, Rajesh.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Pleasure listening to you. 58 years is a long journey, and we've talked about your successes, and it's for all of us to see. But I'm sure there have been certain failures which would have made you think and, you know, it would have taken you to the next. There's a lot of learning that must have happened. So could you share one event where you failed and that taught you something which you could share with us and give us some insights?
You know, I have written my, it's not autobiography, but it's you can call it really autobiography, and taking the high road. Highway. And it has been translated into various languages. I remember when Gujarati edition was being launched in Ahmedabad, my friend who was involved in this launching event, he said, the governor of Gujarat has agreed to launch it, and so you please come. I said, what are you saying? This is simply translation, and the governor of a state coming to launch the book, how it is possible? He said, no, he has agreed, and you please come. So I had to fly. And he said, governor, ke governor ka kaam nahi hai ki kisi ki atmakatha ka vimochan karna. I don't know whether I'm correct in Hindi or not, but this is... Lekin, jab maine Ram Bakshani ki atmakatha padhi, to kidhar bhi karvapan nahi tha. So I have taken only positive things because karvapan is also part of the life, and we why to remember that? Let us forget about that.
Yes.
What's a good name? My name is Dr. Mustafa Sasa.
Yeah, Dr. Mustafa.
You know, listening to the journey of Dr. Ram Buxani, you know, that took me in my past, in my childhood, because my father came in the same year in 1958 when Dr. Ram Buxani came here. And he was, of course, a great friend of my father. And my father, whenever he used to talk about Dubai and the history of Dubai, always, you know, one name he used to always mention, and it was about Mr. Ram Buxani. And today I had an honor to have a evening TV in his office. And again, you know, I was in the flashback, and it was an action replay over here again. An honor to have the book today, you know, of his high road, and also the journey of 60 years on 68 years of their history. And it was really remarkable. What I say is that, you know, wisdom you get from nobles, and he is one of the noble heart over here.
Thank you.
Next question, please. We'll take last three questions.
Very good evening, sir.
Very good evening.
Any of your weakness, please?
Why one? I think a human being is full of weaknesses.
That's a diplomatic answer. Yarika. Can the mic go here, please? Okay, ask from the, yeah. Jigar.
Yeah. Sir, when you had come here 58 years back, so the kind of competition at that time and the kind of competition in your businesses you have today comparatively, so how do you tackle the competitions that you have as of today?
Competition was keen even in those days. It has become keener, but I mean, when we talk about business, competition has always been there throughout the ages. Even maybe 200 years ago also, there were without competition, nothing.
He wants to know your formula to handle the competition.
Sorry?
He wants to know what formula you used to handle the competition.
Basically, you should be sincere, you should be clear, competition won't touch you.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Behind every successful man, there is a woman.
Mm.
So, I want to know the name of lucky lady.
Yes, behind me also there is a woman.
I need to know the name, sir. Maybe everyone wants to know.
She is my wife. And you know how she helps me. She does not interfere in what I do.
That's a good one. Thank you.
Can you please repeat the question? So, Lakshmi, this answer you played 4-5 times in the recording. I think a lot of men will benefit. Yes, Lakshmanan.
Dr. Ram Buxani, very interesting listening to you. One question is, do you have any mentors even today with whom you talk to as a sounding board, either in terms of your business or in terms of your initiative, social initiative which you do?
I think a person, he himself is a great mentor to himself. Just sit quiet, go in the prayer place, ask questions to yourself and you will get the answers. Discuss it, argue on that, and ultimately you will come winner.
Superb. Actually, what Dr. Ram Buxani said is what Shah Rukh Khan does every day. His mentor is his bathroom mirror. Seriously, he talks to himself every single day. And he becomes a better person every time he speaks to us.
And you should, while doing that, you should be totally neutral, not biased. And that will happen because once you start, you are sincere about getting the proper answer, you will get it. Just sit quiet in your prayer place or anywhere and just start asking the questions yourself and you will get the answer.
Rekha. Last two questions. After you, Rekha, we conclude. Yes.
Hmm. Sir, if you come to Dubai today, like let us say if you are 18 year old today, and if you come to Dubai today, how will you do the things differently? Or you will start the journey in the same way?
I think that depends how, in what age you have come, but if you are destined to do this way, you will do different. Definitely, when I came here, there was no planning or decision that I am coming to Dubai. But then destiny led you and you just kept on accepting. Okay, things are a little different and but sincerity has to be there always.
Clap for Dr. Ram Buxani for a very interesting session.
Thank you.
And it's a great honor to have you over here, sir. And before we leave for the evening, I would want you to know every person in this hall because it is truly a historic evening for us. We can begin from here. The gentleman speaker from PwC who had a very interesting session in the evening. For the people I'm meeting first time, if you can just introduce in one statement. Whom I know I'll introduce. That is Shabir Bhai from Dubai. Long many years in Dubai. He's into real estate development in Bangalore and other parts of India. He's into big time hardware business in Dubai. The ma'am next to him. That is Jess Philip George here, a young entrepreneur into the air conditioning system supplying to US, Canada and all the high profile countries, very well established business in Dubai. That's Mr. Philip who came all the way from India, from Kerala and is a very established businessman in Dubai, working around in multiple countries including India. Geeta Nagu is an industrialist from Chennai, we all know, we met her. And she's into education, she's into construction, she's into investment, she's also into entertainment. They own one of the most prominent malls in, one of the most renowned cinema halls in Chennai called Kamala Theater. Mr. Nagarajan is a very proficient gentleman in the real estate sector. Shugra coincidentally happens to be my wife. She handles the education wing of my business. Nago Chidambaram is an industrialist from Chennai. He is into industries, automobile industries, entertainment, media, construction and education. Devang Shah is a developer from Mumbai, second generation. Ralph Pereira is an engineer. He exports 92% of what he manufactures to the United States of America. Mr. JC Kapoor is into the cosmetics business. Rekha is a wellness ambassador for 95 countries. And she also is going to celebrate the Wellness Day in India, which will be celebrated across the world. Shailendra Thatte is a very proficient advocate in the copyrights and intellectual property rights. Amol Welling is into the hospitality industry. Makran Joshi is one of the largest company secretary firm in India who's employed a large number of company secretaries in his organization. Sunny is into construction in the automated construction mechanism, which is the order of the day today. Mr. Atmaram Parab, he's the king for Leh and Ladakh. Nobody knows Leh and Ladakh as much as he knows. He's the brand ambassador for Leh and Ladakh. He's a government guest in that particular state, doing a brilliant job. That's Mr. Mahesh Yadav. He runs the famous restaurant Gypsy and they are also into materials procurement. His brother is one of the topmost architects in India, Mr. Suhash Deshpande. Mr. Lakshman, he is a financial advisor and ex-banker. Mr. Deepak Bhimani is one of the best dealers for Kirloskar pumps in the country. Pallavi Desai is a
Vastu consultant. Rohit Rao is a developer and also he is a management consultant. Vishnu Prasad, a very interesting gentleman here. We feel very proud whenever I introduce Vishnu. He is the world's largest eye care company or a wellness center. Arvind Eye Hospital, I'm sure people must have heard. And Arvind Eye Hospital is a case study in Harvard. Under the same family, he belongs to, his mother is actually the, his mother and mother's brother are the creators of Arvind Eye Care Hospital. And he has created a new entity called Arbindo Eye Care, which has changed the norms in the world as far as eye care is concerned. It is economical today in the world because of this family from Tamil Nadu operating in Madurai. 8 months back, the owners of Google flew in specially in their private jet to meet him and understand how eye care can be improved across the world. So that's Vishnu Prasad for you. Dr. Rajesh Doshi, by qualification a doctor, but he's into jewelry manufacturing. Mr. Vinit Bansode is a business coach and is a signature expert. He can change the fate and the fortunes and your destiny by changing your signature. That's Vinit Bansode. You should clog him after the session. And Manoj Dumre next to her is a father, Manoj Dumre, one of the stalwarts in a place called Dombivli Kalyan in Mumbai. He has got 1 lakh customers, 12 stores. So he services 1 lakh customers. Yes, Mihir is a youngster just doing his education, has come to Dubai to become a racer in life, and I'm sure in the next 5 years he'll be one of the top racers in the world. And he'll carry the logo of St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures at no cost. That's his mother Swati and a very dear friend. She's an interior designer. Harish Mehta is an action coach. He's into the training industry. Amitabh Dhawan heads the real estate sector for L&T in Dubai. Manju Dange is a very proficient lawyer operating out of Dubai and a very dear friend from Pune, settled in Dubai for the last 26 years, doing a brilliant practice in law, legal. That's Tariq. Tariq is into contracting and interiors and exhibition contracting specifically for the stalls. Falida, his wife who works with her in the same business, they also own a brand called Broccoli in Motor City. The gentleman behind him is Venkat. He's into the finance sector and also into event management. Mr. Chokalingam is a very fantastic gentleman who has just successfully done a business event for his community. They come from the Chettiar community and they did an event in Dubai where Chettiars came from all across the world. It was a 2 days event with 1,000 entrepreneurs from their community across the world. He single-handedly handled the success of that. He's also a very successful finance industry gentleman. Thank you, Mr. Chokalingam, for being here. Mr. Atik Merchant is a very dear friend and a developer from Mumbai who's established himself in Dubai for the last 2 decades or more and doing a lot of real estate sector. Mr. Pawan Batavia, again into the property sector. He is himself a big investor. He runs a private fund also for investing into real estate. He does business in Dubai and India. Sunny is one of the most brilliant financial advisors I have ever come across. He's a part of the Citibank team and one of the finest youngsters I've met in the recent times with hands-on knowledge of what he does and the way he advises. Thank you, Sunny, for being here. The gentleman, young gentleman behind you is Jigar. They are hands-on technology. He and his wife, Jessel. They're one of the best in the online building of any social media or any app development in India, operating out of Kandivali in Mumbai. That's Nitin Chauhan. Nitin Chauhan is in the real estate sector. He also is a supply. He does supplies to 5-star hotels in India. In Dubai, he has been a school friend from school times. We are good friends. And Nitin Chauhan is in Dubai for the last, I think, 20 to 25 years. Pratap Dange, one of the most admirable friends I have in the legal fraternity in Dubai. He runs a very successful law firm called King's Exim. And a very great human being to know, a man with great knowledge. Fantastic. Mr. Kailash Biani, again from Mumbai. He owns a company called Asian Stock Market. He's in the stock market industry and investments into a lot of other sectors. Mr. Kailash Biani, thanks for being here. The gentleman behind is Ashirwad Somani, and Ashirwad Somani is a dear friend, one of the best real estate companies that we know in broking in Dubai. He has been our associate from the first day that we stepped into Dubai almost 3 years back. Thanks, Ashirwad, for being here and for being with us. That is Mr. Prabha. Prabha is the international operations head for us in our Dubai office for St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures. The gentleman in the front is a young, large landlord, Mr. Vijay Sorana. Yeah, I was talking about you only. He is into the property business, operates out of Chennai. Mr. Pawan Lohia, he is a champion in the real estate market as far as contracting, construction and all that is concerned. Rambhai is into Dubai for the last 35 to 40 years, one of the best contracting companies. They are specialized in doing finishing projects for 5-star, 7-star properties, hotels and private houses, homes, whatever. So that's Rambhai here. Nirmal is into textiles for the last 15-20 years, operates out of Dubai. He's basically a Bandra boy, operates out of Dubai, and currently he's also getting involved with the real estate sector. And Suhani here is a very, very dear friend. She does all the event management for St. Angelo's. Event management is a time pass for us, for her. She is the wife of Mr. Vivek Mendonca, who owns the Lawrence and Mayo, which is in India, across the country, which is one of the oldest eye care company, the lenses company in the country, Lawrence and Mayo, for 135 years. Her husband's great-grandfather bought it from the Britishers before they left. So that's Suhani, and Suhani's friend and also a dear friend of mine. Now please come up. Again, a very historical figure. She is herself a very successful personality in the field of art, but she also happens to be the granddaughter of Mr. M.F. Hussain. Her husband is also one of the renowned personalities in India who has been entertaining Mumbai and the rest of the country for many years, Mr. Ashwin Gidwani. Any international band or any international play or any international creativity which happens in Mumbai, Mr. Ashwin Gidwani is the authority and the man behind the event. So friends, we had a very interesting gathering. Thanks
before
a lot,
we,
Dr. Ram Baksani.
Before we wrap up, I want to...
Lakshmi, the great team behind News 18 which made this event successful. Aishwarya.
We're not done yet. I request you to
just last
hold
minute.
On for a few minutes.
Manvi here from the News 18 team. Aishwarya, who did the local coordinations.
And
a great
crew.
Team, the crew here.
Parag and Amber, who are there, they've been live casting this event. They also flew down along with the rest of the Network 18 team. Thank you for
the
live cast on YouTube, Facebook, and all of that.
And one last bit, I would like to request Mr. Philip George to come up. I would like to request Mr. Vishnu to please come up and offer the cup. One last gift, a very interesting gift. I would like to request Dr. Rajesh Doshi to come up. He's in the jewelry industry, exports to the US, has a fantastic manufacturing industry in Andheri at Seeps. And he's giving a precious gift to Dr. Ram Baksani. These are precious stones made in silver and natural stones. Love My Jewelry is the name of the brand. Dr. Rajesh Doshi is quite generous enough to extend it to our chief guest.